What's going on, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of Hyperbole in the title, because I'm a slave to the algorithm. As always, I am your host, Zach Cronin, and today we are talking about not the first blockbuster trade that happened because of Damian Lillard, but the second blockbuster trade that happened because of Damian Lillard. I, of course, am talking about Jrue Holiday being traded to the Boston Celtics. This move was done because there is an arms race happening in the Eastern Conference. There was no way that Jrue Holiday was going to spend that season on the Portland Trail Blazers. He is too talented, too good on both ends of the floor, too much of an asset to a championship caliber team to stay in the Pacific Northwest. The full details of the trade was him going to Boston for Malcolm Brogdon, Robert Williams, a 2024 first round pick, and a 2029 second round pick. There is also a 2024 conditional first round pick that is included, but more or less it was Robert Williams and Malcolm Brogdon plus the two picks going to Portland for Jrue Holiday. Now, I've probably titled this video something along the lines of "I'm scared of the Boston Celtics. The Boston Celtics are spooky. The Boston Celtics are frightening." That is semi-true, semi-not true. Part of it is because it is October and we're getting ready for Halloween, so make the title a little festive. I personally, and also as a fan of the Brooklyn Nets, I am not actually frightened by the Boston Celtics because they pose no threat to my team in any way. They are significantly better than Brooklyn, so there's really no room for heartbreak here. They might meet up in the first round, and if they do meet up in the first round, they might push it to five games, but I'm not really too concerned about that. I tweeted this a few days ago, but basically, there are two teams in the Eastern Conference. It is Boston and it is Milwaukee. They're the two best, and then it's everybody else. I'm not particularly concerned about any other team coming out of the East. There's a lot of uncertainty around Philly. The Knicks are good. I made a video on them a few weeks ago praising them. The Knicks are a solid team, but in no way, shape, or form are they going to contend for a title this year. Cleveland, maybe. I don't know. Miami, I don't know. There's a lot of uncertainty with those two teams, even though they are on the, even though they are closer to great than they are not. I don't know if they have enough to take down either Boston or Milwaukee. And that's what every team in the East is going to be building for, at least the teams that feel that they're close to being able to contend for a title. Obviously, teams like Chicago, Charlotte, Brooklyn, Atlanta, they're not really too concerned about those, about the two teams at the top of the conference, because they're not going to sniff the two teams at the top of the conference. I would be anything but shocked. I would be flabbergasted. I would be bamboozled if Boston and Milwaukee did not meet in the Eastern Conference final. The only thing that changes that is if Philadelphia and James Harden find a way to mend their relationship and James Harden actually performs like the James Harden that we know, the 20-10 guy, the guy who can give you 35 on nights when Embiid doesn't have it. But I don't know. James Harden is kind of petty. It was reported earlier that he was present with the team and participating in practices at Colorado State, but who knows? This is a long NBA season. Anything is possible with that team, with if they either get better or they deteriorate. I find myself believing more that they're going to deteriorate, but let's go ahead and talk about this Boston Celtics team, because they're fucking loaded. Both Milwaukee and Boston are absolutely packed with talent. Also, want to make it clear that I am also, you know, I think that Milwaukee and Boston are just as good as one another. They are built almost identically. The only reason I'm not putting Milwaukee in the title of this video is because I already made a video on them and Damian Lillard. And Damian Lillard obviously drastically impacts the landscape of the Eastern Conference. And if it were not for Damian Lillard, Boston wouldn't even be in a position to sign Jrue Holiday. So let's go ahead. We're going to look at their roster real quick. Jrue Holiday, Kristaps Porzingis, whom they also acquired this past offseason, Jason Tatum, Jaylen Brown, Derek White, and Al Horford. Those are the six core members of the Celtics rotation. Peyton Pritchard is on the books for this year as well. O'Shea Brissett is on the books for this year as well. Luke Kornet is on the books, albeit unguaranteed. You also have Delano Banton, Sam Hauser, Jordan Walsh. That is the full Celtics salary cap, although I do not feel that any of these guys that I just mentioned outside of Peyton Pritchard and potentially Luke Kornet see significant minutes. I think that Pritchard does work his way in the rotation for 15, 18, 20 minutes a night because he has proven to give this team something in the past. I mean, his energy in the postseason last year was remarkable. Really, the six guys whom the Celtics are going to key on are the six guys that I mentioned at the top. Holiday, Tatum, Brown, KP, Al Horford, Derek White. That is a very solid six-man lineup. You really have no holes on either side of the floor with this team. Just for some perspective about how, forget the offense, fuck the offense entirely. We need to talk about how suffocating this team is going to be on defense. So I went ahead, I pulled up some numbers. I went to the NBA's defensive dashboard. Among high volume defenders, this is an arbitrary benchmark that I placed at 15 defended field goal attempts per game. There are two members of this group that are on the Boston Celtics, Kristaps Porzingis and Al Horford. Among defended field goal percentage allowed while contesting 15 or more shots per game, Kristaps Porzingis was at 44% and Al Horford was at 45%, good for the third and fifth best marks respectively. The only people ahead of KP were Draymond Green and Cade Cunningham, and Cade only played 12 games because of his injury, but very good defensive unit. Of course, you have Jaylen Brown, who is a fantastic defender on the perimeter. You have Jason Tatum, who has become a better defender on the perimeter, has really understood how to use his length and his size to be bothersome, particularly against somebody like Kevin Durant, which is not an easy job to step into as a young defender. And of course, there's not enough I could say about Jrue Holiday on the perimeter, arguably the best defensive guard in the association. You also pair that with Derek White coming off the bench, it's going to be very difficult for the Celtics opponents to score on them. And you combine that with the fact that this unit has been playing together for multiple years. They understand each other. They understand the system they're going to play. And what's crazy is they traded away Marcus Smart and replaced Marcus Smart with someone who is better than Marcus Smart on the offensive end of the court. Jrue Holiday is a 20-7 type player. He's a guy who is a reliable shooter from the perimeter. This offense is going to look entirely different than the past 2 or 3 years because not only do you add Jrue Holiday, you swap Robert Williams out for Kristaps Porzingis. Now, understand that KP is probably not the same level of rim protector that Robert Williams was. I mean, this was a guy who was in the running for Defensive Player of the Year, but KP is a very good defensive player, evidenced by the metrics I just threw at you. He also averaged like 1.5 blocks per game last year. During his early days with the Knicks, was closer to 2 blocks per game. And on top of that, he is developed so nicely as an offensive player. Really, I don't want to say it was an underrated reaction because I don't really know how to gauge that, but I do feel like this was not an acquisition that was talked about enough because KP has improved. He's improved considerably everywhere. Is coming off a season where he averaged 22 points, 8 rebounds, just shy of 3 assists, shot 50% from the field, damn near shot 38.5% from 3. Does have some injury concerns here and there, but that's a chance you take on a guy who is drastically going to improve your offense. KP can play on the perimeter. He can play in the post. Al Horford, although he's not really a stretch 5, can also play on the perimeter a little bit. Granted, I would want Porzingis out there more than Horford, but Horford's ability to facilitate from the high post, from the low post, from the top of the key, from the free throw line, there are just so many unique wrinkles and so many interesting opportunities for this Celtics team on offense as well as on defense. The versatility in these lineups is damn near unrivaled, really only by a team like the Denver Nuggets or a team like the Milwaukee Bucks. Both of your guards, Holiday and White, can guard 1, 2, and sometimes 3. I would put Jrue Holiday on a small forward. I'm really not concerned about his size because he's still a big guard. He's still a big athletic guard. Jason Tatum and Jaylen Brown can pretty much guard 1 through 4. Al Horford in particular is one of the better defensive centers in the league. I don't think anyone is going to argue that. Fantastic. Pretty much everywhere and anywhere. And on top of that, he's a seasoned vet. He understands how to play defense at a high level because he's been playing defense at a high level. On top of that, his ability to secure rebounds and close out possessions on defense and just doing little things like boxing out, communication, everything you want from your defensive anchor, Al Horford provides, and he also provides a little bit of a boost on offense as well. But I want to compare this team to Milwaukee because, as I mentioned at the top of the show, they're really similar to each other. They match up very well against one another. Dame, Giannis, Middleton, Brooke Lopez, Bobby Portis, Pat Connaughton, Marjon Beauchamp, Malik Beasley, Jay Crowder, Robin Lopez, and Adrian Green. That's the full salary cap for Milwaukee. However, much like with Boston, not all of these guys are going to see considerable minutes. I don't think Beauchamp is going to play a lot. Beasley could work his way into the rotation. Very good three-point shooter. Pat Connaughton is a mainstay in the rotation. Bobby Portis is a mainstay in the rotation. Jay Crowder is probably going to be a mainstay in the rotation. Really, the only edge that Boston has over Milwaukee is at point guard on defense. Jrue Holiday is a significantly better defender than Damian Lillard. I mentioned this in the video that I did on the Damian Lillard trade, but the trade-off with Dame being so bad on defense is that he just averaged 30-7 on like 38% from three, and you have to pick him up once he crosses half court. I do also want to mention that the Bucks, just like the Celtics, also have two elite high-volume defenders. You have Giannis, who I don't think defended as many shots as KP and Horford, but Giannis is an elite defender. You also have Brooke Lopez, who was really remarkable. He averaged more defended field goal attempts than anybody else last year, I'm fairly certain. And he still held his opponents to like 45% shooting. Just, again, elite on the back end. The perimeter might be a little bit of a hassle for Milwaukee to defend. Chris Middleton is a below average defender at best. I already mentioned Damian Lillard, but you have Jay Crowder, you have Pat Connaughton. Do not get it twisted, folks. I feel Milwaukee is going to be a top seven defense in the NBA this year, maybe even top five. I think that Giannis and Brooke on the back end is just too much to bet against. And also, they don't have to be the best defense in the league to contend for a title. You just have to be an above average defense. I think the year that they won in 2021, they were like the seventh or ninth best defense. And you pair that with what could be the most dynamic offense in the NBA. You have not a title favorite, but you would not be stupid to bet money on Milwaukee to win, much like you would not be stupid to put money on Boston to win. I'm hesitant to say that the winner of a potential series between these two goes on to win the NBA Finals because I don't feel that you should bet against the Denver Nuggets. They deserve to be projected as the favorites to repeat. But then also, you look at the Nuggets on paper, you look at what they did last season, you look at how they managed to patch all of their holes or all of their concerns from previous seasons. Jokic, Murray, Michael never swing the rock, Porter Jr. I mean, Christian Brown gave them some fantastic minutes last season. But I want to keep this on the Boston Celtics. I feel that Boston could be the best team in the East. You're not going to be able to say definitively which one between Boston or Milwaukee is going to be better until the final game of the season. I think they're just going to trade spots at the top of the standings for the entirety of the year, at least from December on until March. But it's going to be a very exciting year of basketball, a very exciting season of basketball for both Celtics and Bucks fans. And I'm not going to lie, as a basketball fan myself, even though I am a staunch Celtics hater, I will be tuning in to more Celtics games because I want to see what this offense looks like. I want to see what this team looks like because it is so drastically overhauled from the season before. They're basically taking on a whole new identity. They traded three guys who were integral to their success last season, and they still managed to field a team that is going to contend for a title. I think it's just really fantastic team building on the front office's part. I think that there's plenty of star power on this team as well. Like them and Milwaukee should be the favorites to finish at the top of the standings this year. And again, I'm not choosing one quite yet because ultimately, it doesn't fucking matter which one you choose. They're both good enough to be in that conversation. And with that, I'm going to go ahead and close this video out. Thank you guys so very much for coming to hang out with me today. Everything I'm associated with is down in the description box below. Twitter, Instagram, TikTok. Subscribe to the channel. Leave a like on this video. If you liked it, leave a comment as well. It really helps out with the algorithm. I'm sure it will be linked somewhere in this video. But if you want to hear my thoughts on the Damian Lillard trade, that is the most recent video I posted. So go ahead. Check all that out. With that, I'll catch y'all in the next one.